Hey there, and welcome to another episode of Interama. Today, we're going to be continuing the work on the park. In fact, we're going to start laying the grounds for the new international sector. Actually, it's not new, it's old, but we're going to be sort of expanding from the main area that we worked on in the previous episode. But, I mean, there's going to be a very detail-oriented video, and before we start expanding things, I wanted to come back to the main entrance, which is, you know, what you see right here, and start sort of filling in the gaps, because I left this whole segment somewhat undetailed. I wanted to come back here and, for example, take a look at the little water fountains that we have, because, I mean, obviously these were just placeholders, but they didn't look super great or interesting, so I decided to come back and as you can see, we have this sort of gap of grass in between the paths, and I wanted to hide that somehow. However, since we don't have circular paths to do that, I decided to use a technique from Silverit, where you basically lay down in this case a line of concrete, and then you rotate it along its axis, and you basically clip it all over, you know, on top of one another. And then you just sink it into the ground, just barely, you know, just a little bit over the path, so you can see the texture underneath. And in this case, we had to hide the little curbs from the path. There's an option in the path menu that allows you to do that. And I thought that looked fantastic, so I went for it, and then I realized that the patterns that I was using, you know, the different textures for the paths, since I have some brighter ones and some darker ones, having the bright ones so close to this super bright circular concrete base for the fountain didn't look so great, so I decided to sort of change that, and it took me a little while to get a pattern that I was happy with, but in the end, I think it came out fantastic. And over here, I actually went back and added the little curbs on that segment of paths, just so that I was able to perfectly center, or, you know, quote-unquote perfectly center the fountain in the area that I wanted. And once I was happy with that location, I just decided to clone it, and as you can see here, I'm using the paths on the corner to perfectly center that second fountain in place, together with now all the effects, like the water splash thing. I don't know what the water jet stream, I think it's called. I basically embedded all of that into one building, so that allows me to reuse it as many times as I want. And then for the sort of the main fountain, or the main pond here, because it's actually going to be turned into a fountain. Man, spoiler alert, I should have not said that. Actually, you're going to see it in just a moment, so it doesn't really matter. But I decided to sort of change the shape of this fountain, make it into a rectangle instead of a, you know, that weird shape that we did before. And again, it will take me a little while of trial and error to play with the textures on the main ground, but I was actually really happy with how everything flows. And obviously I'm reusing this sort of, you know, the two pillars and the brick wall with a little wooden top. And I feel like it's gonna be sort of the signature element for multiple parts of the park. You're gonna see it, me using it in other locations in just a few minutes during this time lapse. But I wanted to sort of create a bit of a, you know, a bigger fountain that obviously has a few more jet streams, I guess, if that's really the word. You'll see it in a moment. But what I'm doing here is just duplicating and rotating the different pieces to get all of the corners matching. And I'm gonna be using that wooden railing. This is the first time I'm using this in the park, and I wanna be using it quite a bit because I love how it looks. I think the original one has a bit of a, you know, if you just grab it from the tool set, it just has this like nasty green texture, which would have been nice, but I wanted to sort of match the concrete pillars that have the lights on the top. So I just went ahead and painted them in, you know, that kind of beige, kind of creamy color, and I thought they looked great. Now, I wanted to, what I'm doing here basically is I wanted to hide the grass. I wanted this to look like a man-made type of pool, you know, something that's you know, someone actually, there's like piping going on. It's not like a natural pond. I really didn't want the grass to show up at all. So I decided to create sort of this building with steps so that, you know, it looks like you can see no traces of greenery here. And I think it came out fantastic. I'm also using some sort of the same concrete segments that I use for the round fountains that sort of bring everything together. And this was not my favorite part. When I did this, I thought it was like, man, this looks so realistic. I used the metal windows from like the futuristic theme, put them underwater and put the jet streams locked on that. And it totally looks like the mechanism for like a water fountain, you know, like a dancing waters kind of fountain. I thought that was pretty awesome. So I decided to keep it that way and really didn't touch it ever again. I mean, at least for the rest of this episode, I won't touch it. Now, we needed something, you know, something important, something that shows what the hell this park is. So I figured that one of these custom signs was due for this one. So I decided to go for that. I wish that they had more or better fonts, because most of them are pretty ugly. In fact, it would have been amazing if you can just upload your own artwork. I mean, that shouldn't be super hard. If any of the game developers are watching this, that would be kind of cool just to have a shape that you can upload like a PNG or something over it and, you know, sort of customize the exact look and feel that you want. I wouldn't put my like really obnoxious super, you know, 80s logo on top of that, but I guess one can only dream. Over here, by the way, I don't know if you noticed, but I added a few little details, some like planters around the main gates, and I'm only doing that to sort of hide the grass that was just sitting there. That whole area to me was like very under detailed, and I wanted to at least apply some sort of a temporary measure, you know, like a temporary patch, so that it didn't look so barren. We'll definitely come back to that, but let me talk about what I'm doing here, because it may seem a little bit weird. So those paths that you see me at there are the only reason why I'm putting them, it's and then that sort of configuration, it's because I'm using them as a measuring tool. I actually have, during you know, the recording of this video, I usually have another monitor with Google Maps open, and I'm using the measuring tool to sort of you know, measure the distance between the different elements of the park. That way I can get the spacing, you know, between the different areas to, you know, to be some sort of somewhat accurate, I guess is what I'm trying to say. It's not 100% accurate, not even close, actually. But it still gives me a pretty rough idea of where elements should be. And what I'm doing here is laying down the grounds for a little pond that kind of goes around the a second bridge for the train tracks, which we're gonna actually put down in just a minute. It's pretty exciting. The train won't really work because I only have one station, but we're gonna have some tracks and we're definitely gonna see the train in action, even though it's gonna crash just a few meters down the line. I'm getting ahead of myself. But what I'm doing here again is just laying down the main path that will sort of connect this international sector, which is officially what I'm working on right now. And as you can see, I'm trying to place the first train station, which will be on this little corner. And this took me, man, this took me so long to, this is the first time, well, technically it's not the first time I'm doing like this type of work, because I did it in the alpha version, but I think the controls were really different when I built my first and only coaster. Yes, so this is pretty much my second attempt at doing this kind of infrastructure. And it took me, you know, a few minutes of trial and error. And when I say minutes, probably a good hour of trial and error just to get this little curve to, you know, slope super smooth into the bridge. As you can see, it's kind of elevated. It's really messy. I realized that you can just create segments of the train tracks and then just edit the segments in between. So that's pretty much what I end up doing, even though it's sometimes really difficult to sort of get it stuck or, you know, be completely flat against the ground, especially because you can't really terraform once you put the train tracks in place. It will, like, if you try to like elevate the train, it will create like cliffs on both sides, but it will try to keep the terrain completely flat. You can carve it down, but as you can see there, I can't really go up, that was kind of a pain. I was able to get it to a good spot. I mean, it's definitely not perfect, and I might even come back to it, because again, it's mostly trial and error. I wish there was some sort of, you know, slope tool for terraforming, just like there is one in City Skylines. I know I keep comparing this game to City Skylines. I'm sorry, it's I just can't help it. There's a few things that I would love that exist in City Skylines to be here, and vice versa as well, just so you know. One of them will be, I mean, if we had something like the Move It tool for Planet Coaster, oh man, that would be so amazing. For those of you who don't know, like don't play City Skylines at all, the Move It tool allows you to like select a whole bunch of props and duplicate them and rotate them and move them in multiple ways. It's so convenient. You don't have to like group stuff in buildings, which we'll get to in just a few minutes down this time lapse. There's actually a whole section of real-time work in this video, so stay tuned for that. But as you can see, I was just testing the train. It completely crashes after that second little overpass that we did, and I started working on just adding a few decorations, just putting a ton of trees around this little pond that kind of like circles around. There's even like a tiny island, and just wanted to have a bit of a mesh of different kinds of trees. In fact, we're gonna come back later at the real-time portion of this video and add a few more bushes and, you know, overall vegetation. Whereas here, this bridge that goes across the pond, I tried to sort of integrate it, you know, with the shorelines. In this case, that terrain kind of ends abruptly. So I grabbed some of the design elements from the overpass that goes across the main entrance and tried to use the same elements to, you know, kind of replicate the same aesthetic. Even here, I'm grabbing the entrance railings to build what, I mean, this is going to be a bit of a lookout point. And by the way, this doesn't exist in the real park. There's actually many things that I'm doing on this episode that don't really exist in the real park, but I just decided that I needed a bit of a break in an otherwise unfeatured path, I thought this was kind of cool to have a bit of a lookout point that you can see the pond and the train in the back. And over here, this one, from what I can gather from Google Maps, does exist, which is a bit of a pier that, you know, goes into the pond. And obviously I had to like redo the pond a little bit because it turned out to be a little bit larger. So I push the island back and the shoreline, you know, closer to the path as well. And I started pretty much clipping a building over it. As you can see, I started with this wooden planks, which I later changed because they look a little bit too rustic for the aesthetic that I wanted to do, especially since you'll see in a moment that we're going to be reusing the the wooden railings that that I put, you know, near the fountain at the entrance and the lookout point that I just saw a second ago. And I think it looks a little bit too high class. You're just gonna see it in a moment here once I pick it up. There you go. I feel like that doesn't match, you know, those rustic wooden planks, so but I did love everything else about this build, so I decided to keep everything but the flooring, and you're gonna see me change it in just a few moments. In fact, once I put down the benches, not those, but let me see, I'm just gonna change it in a moment. There you go. So those modern benches don't really fit that theme, so I went ahead and just changed it. But before I did that, I wanted to sort of continue with the same pattern, the same, you know, design language, and bring back the the brick wall with the top wood plank and the two concrete pillars with the lights. And man, just everything fits so much nicely. And also added, you know, like a hint of a different texture in the path by changing that whole segment. It kind of highlights, you know, the different features that you'll see, you know, it's almost like a way of wayfinding, in a sense. So we're going back to the main entrance here, and as you can see, I'm just adding lights, because this whole area, it's still super dark. Even at the end of this episode, it will still be dark, but it will look so much nicer. I wanted to sort of create different accents alongside the entrance, and just not just, you know, the actual specific entrance, but the whole, you know, entrance kind of hall. I keep saying entrance. I don't know. I need to find better words for this. But what I'm doing here is I wanted to sort of translate the branding of Interama and basically the logo that I created for the series into the game somehow. And I decided, or I realized that the best way to do that would be to use lights. And in this case, I'm using this spotlights where you can just change the shade of the color. So you can see me do that. And I'm going for like a pink and orange, you know, kind of gold style. And even there underneath the overpass, the train overpass, I'm using that to sort of mark, you know, different segments of the park. I think that looks fantastic. And I'm probably going to be using that throughout the rest of this, you know, facility, if you will. All these design elements, by the way, it is kind of important. I'm going to be reusing most of these, which that doesn't mean that I'm only going to use that. I mean, the different sectors of the park will have different styles as well, but I do want to keep some consistency. I want to have some sort of base design language, and, you know, all these elements that I keep reusing over and over again, like the concrete pillars and the brick walls and, you know, the gold and pink lights are going to be pretty much a constant throughout the park, but they're not going to be the only ones. So just, you know, to make that clear. And what am I doing here with the fountains, you may ask? Well, I just decided to add more lights to it. And since I grouped everything against, you know, the building group, I had to replop them. And this, all right, so this was probably my favorite part for this whole episode. I'm doing a water fountain, one of those fountains that you can walk into and they have like random jets of water coming out. So if you're not careful, you'll get, splashed with water. And hopefully it's summer when that happens to you. Otherwise you'll be, very cold. And basically what I'm doing here is I'm just kind of trying the same technique I did with the fountain. I'm clipping this building right up against the edge of the floor. We're gonna get rid of the curves in just a moment, but I'm positioning small jets of water, the ones that are intermittent, so they're not constant, and just put them, you know, four by tile, kind of, it's the pattern that I chose. I know that they are a little bit over, you know, the style, and in real life they will be like completely shallow against the ground, but I did want to get the extra texture when I was looking at them from above, which is basically all the time. And then I put some larger ones in the middle and some mini ones are, you know, kind of around it, so you can get like a bit of a pyramid type design. And there you go. So I hit all of the curves and put it, you know, flash against the ground. By the way, this concrete texture is amazing. There's so much detail in it. I love it. I'm gonna reuse the crap out of that. The last touch here is to sort of, you know, make this whole area a little bit greener, add a few more details. So I decided to use those, you know, planters that I made for the main path leading to the entrance. And reuse them as much as I could for the little corners. All of the lights that you see me add here are very modern, and these are also the case in the real park, so that's why I chose those. But they light up the place really nice at night, and I think they look great. So all that's left for me to do now is put a few benches, and that's pretty much it for this time lapse. Alright, welcome to the real-time part of this episode. And before we jump into adding details to that little corner of the map that we just created, there's one little tip that I want to share with you. And this was actually left by one of the viewers in the previous video in reply to a comment that I made that it would have been nice for Planet Coaster to sort of have an option to toggle the UI on and off. It turns out that there's actually a shortcut that allows you to do just that. And the shortcut is right control, right shift and G. So as you can see, I can turn it on and off at will. And I highly encourage you to check it out because this is great for, you know, if you're doing cinematics or if you're just simply taking screenshots, hiding the UI, it's actually, you know, the way to go instead of, because I mean, in my case, I used to like have it on and scale up the footage, which was, you know, not the best quality, or just simply cropping the middle part of the screen and getting rid of the UI. Yeah, don't do any of that. Just simply do right control, right shift, and G. I know it's a bit of an odd shortcut, like why not left control, but or left shift, but it works. It works and it's great. And hopefully it's useful for you too. Now let's actually, you know, do some work. I'm gonna bring your attention to this little corner of the map. And as you can see, I already kind of added a few little details here. I wanted to sort of, you know, make the shoreline of this little pond that pretty much loops around under the train tracks. And there's a little bit tiny island here. So I wanna spend some time adding details pretty much throughout this area. You saw some of this during the time-lapse probably, if I didn't cut it out. But the problem is that in this case, Planet Coaster doesn't allow you to duplicate this. So I created all of these, placing them one by one. And the problem is that, you know, like I said, you can't duplicate. If I select them all, I mean, I can move them, but I really can't create a new copy of those, you know, of that little group of bushes or trees or props, basically. The only solution to do that, from what I can gather, is to sort of group all of those bushes in a building. So for example here, all of these props are pretty much the same type of props that these are. However, these are grouped together based on a building that just, you know, it's hidden underground. So if I click duplicate here, you can actually see it. These walls are basically the thing that defines a building. In my mind, I think buildings are more like groups, or that's pretty much how I'm treating them. And then you simply append all of these props to that building. So this is the only way that I found that you can sort of reuse the same elements over and over again without going crazy. I think I'm gonna try the same here. So the first thing that I'm gonna do is create a building. So I'm gonna go into the walls section, and you can use most of these types, but I specifically want to use a wooden post or something similar so that I get a small profile, especially because if I were to choose, for example, a roof, which would also work, it's such a big footprint that since we are trying to sort of mix this alongside the shoreline, it's possible that, you know, this concrete tile will actually show. So I'm trying to go for something, you know, very, very, you know, small profile. And the wooden post, I think it's sort of the best for this type of creation. Now we need to pick sort of a style for the little short line and the bushes that we want to introduce, and I think we can go with these types of really dark bushes. What are they called? The creosote bush or something like that. So we want to basically create a line here. So now we have this sort of line. Wow, the wooden pole is like, it doesn't matter, it's way away from the building itself. But with this, we can just simply go duplicate and bring it to the desired area. And I think we're gonna start by sort of creating this, hedge right here on the water. So let's bring this, the camera closer. And we can do something like this. So we're gonna create that. And now we're gonna duplicate it by using the gizmo here. And maybe even rotate it a little bit so that we can start getting at that curve. In fact, we can even duplicate it once more and elevate it in height and bring it back a bit so that it looks a little bit more integrated and not just like, you know, elements put together with no meaning. So something like that. Let's see how that looks. That is not too bad. It really looks like a nasty pond, which is kind of what I'm aiming for, by the way. So let me duplicate this a whole bunch of times, and I'll show you how that looks. So I spent a few minutes off camera just duplicating, you know, that little cluster of dry bushes and also adding a few details here and there that I'm going to show you in just a second. And man, I'm really, really excited with how this is looking. As you can see, I mean, the pond now kind of has a bit of an eerie look to it, which is, you know, the style that I was aiming for. This is not, you know, your typical super manicured pond. I mean, this is, you know, some overgrown stuff happening here. Dead trees and branches. It's all kind of a mess, and I love it because that's literally the exact same aesthetic that I was going for. And even the water kind of has like a murky, grayish, oily color to it, which is perfect. Even, you know, looking at it from this little pier, it's just I love it. I think it's perfect. And one thing that I added that we're probably going to be adding a whole lot is being using the terrain painter filter thing, in this case this texture right here, to sort of paint underneath the trees like so, if I can get there we go. And I thought this was a great addition to the way trees look. I pretty much added everywhere in the map, even here, because usually the grass doesn't grow very well in the shade. So this, I figured it was a nice way to give it a bit of an extra detail to an otherwise dull, repetitive grass pattern. So as you can see, I even added on the shaded areas over here as well. And I also, as I was doing that, I realized that I could use this to sort of highlight the train tracks. So, you know what, let's actually test it a little bit on camera. So we're going to grab the, for example, these rocks. And we're going to be using this quite a bit throughout the map in, you know, multiple or different configurations. So we're going to basically be bringing a bit of a, you know, a bit of a texture there. In fact, we can even use some rocks every now and then. And we can grab clusters of grass too, because why not, right? We don't want everything to be like super perfect, but we do want to sort of bring all these tiles together somewhat. So you can clearly see, I mean, you can compare this to this one, and this obviously looks like more of a beaten path than anything else. Maybe the rock is not the greatest option here, but we definitely want, you know, that little sand there. I think it's pretty good, and also like these patches of like darker darker grass also would go a long ways. This whole area is going to be probably, you know, styled in future episodes, but I think for now I'm pretty happy with how this looks. In fact, I do want to come back to this probably in the next episode and add a few more rocks, because I think, you know, the bushes alone, even though they look great, I think we need, you know, a little bit of an extra, you know, pizzazz, if that makes any sense. But unfortunately, I ran out of time for this episode. If you enjoy, please consider giving this video a like. That's very much appreciated. And also, if you're new to the channel, there's a big red button underneath this video player that you can click in order to become a subscriber. Also, make sure to click the little icon with the bell, which is the notifications in case you want to be notified immediately after one of my videos come out. Finally, there's a link in the description to the full playlist in case you missed an episode. But yeah, that's pretty much it. That's all that I have to say for now. I want to thank you all for watching, and hope to see you in the next one.